Welcome, Dr. Tsai. Let me take a few minutes to introduce you before your speech. Dr. Tsai Ing-wen, I think as everyone knows, is the chairperson of the DPP. Before entering public service, she was a lawyer and a university professor. During the 90s, she was one of the key negotiators when Taiwan was trying to gain accession into the World Trade Organization. Her outstanding performance there led to her recruitment to be the National Security Advisor for President Lee Teng-hui. She also, and this is on the personal front, she is also the first presidential candidate in the Republic of China who has been a member of AmCham. So I think we should all give her a round of applause. So today she's going to talk to us about Taiwan next 10-year policy platform. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Tsai Ing-wen.
Well, thank you very much for that welcome, despite the fact that I'm not the president yet. Well, it's good to be here today and get invited. And as I said before I came into the room, that I really cannot afford not coming here because it's so important to face members of the AmCham here in Taipei. So, good afternoon. You have to be louder. I mean, for DPP, we expect a loud response from our audience, you know. Good afternoon. Yes, good. I wouldn't say things like, but ladies and gentlemen, and especially President Andrew Wu, ladies and gentlemen, it is my great pleasure to be here today, invited by the American Chamber of Commerce to share my thoughts with you on the future challenges and opportunities facing Taiwan and Taiwan's bilateral relations with the U.S. I see many friends and familiar faces, friends and people I have met over the last two decades, either as a trade negotiator or in my capacity as a minister, vice premier, or as a politician. Well, it is my honor to be speaking to you today as the presidential candidate representing the Democratic Progressive Party, that is DPP. Now, the friendship between Taiwan and the U.S. dates back six decades. Over that 60 years, Taiwan and the U.S. have not only been national security partners, but the U.S. is also one of Taiwan's key partners in economic, in trade terms. The U.S. government, as well as U.S. businesses, have become our partners and our strongest support in managing globalization strategically. In the aftermath of the global financial crisis in 2008, nations around the world have undergone major changes. Many of them are experiencing the pain of economic rebalancing and structural adjustment. The global financial and economic orders are also yet to be fully reconstructed. We're facing unprecedented challenges. Despite the challenges, the Asia-Pacific region, especially Asia, has demonstrated relative vitality and the potential for growth in the global economic downturn. We can foresee the region becoming the engine of global economic revitalization and the center of future development. In recent months, we are pleased to note that the U.S. has pledged to increase its engagement with the region and expressed its determination to have more active presence in Asia. With a long-time tradition of the friendship and close business cooperation shared between Taiwan and the U.S., Taiwan will remain as the essential and crucial partner of the U.S. in the region. We look forward to exploring ways of furthering our relationship and to developing a new strategic partnership. Now, Taiwan will hold its presidential election in January 2012. President Ma, like myself, has stressed the importance of Taiwan-U.S. relationship, and in particular, the balance in the trilateral relationship between Taiwan, U.S., and China. I must point out that since 2008, under the Ma administration, the speed of the development between Taiwan and China have far outpaced the relationship between Taiwan and the U.S. So restoring the balance in the trilateral relationship will be one of my key tasks in managing our external relations when I am elected president. Now, I, like the majority of the Taiwanese people, cherish the value and close and stable U.S.-Taiwan relationship we have always shared. In the area of regional security, since the 1950s, the defense assistance provided by the U.S. has been the bedrock for maintaining stability in the Taiwan Strait. This security provided an environment free from Chinese military threats and allowed the people of Taiwan to pursue economic prosperity and universal values such as freedom, democracy, and human rights. With this, I wish to thank the continuing support from the members of the MCHAN for arms sales to Taiwan. Now, in the area of Taiwan-U.S. economic relations, our partnership has evolved from the early days of U.S. economic assistance in the 1950s to the U.S. becoming Taiwan's largest trading partner and destination for our exported goods in the 80s. Back then, almost half of our total export value was destined for the U.S. Today, the U.S. remains our third largest trading partner. In 2010, trade between the two sides was valued at $56.8 billion. The economic importance of U.S., of course, the importance of U.S. to Taiwan actually far exceeds what the trade figures suggest. The importance of the Taiwan-U.S. business partnership can be illustrated by Taiwan's role as the world's leading IT supplier. Taiwan and U.S. companies, along with Taiwan businesses in China, have successfully and firmly established an irreplaceable strategic business alliance in the IT industry by, quote, connecting the vast marketplaces and digital powerhouse of the U.S. with the enormous manufacturing centers of China, unquote, as described in 2005 Business Week article, and which remain just as true today. Now, I wish to use the opportunity today to point out that this is the best timing for furthering and developing a new strategic partnership between Taiwan and the U.S. The financial crisis, coupled with the sovereign debt crisis, have led governments to realize that traditional monetary and financial policies are no longer sufficient tools in managing growing unemployment and rebuilding the economy. The only possible solution left for global economic recovery is to find new engines for economic growth and development. Global trends are beginning to show that harnessing Asia's growth and dynamism and broadening cooperation with the region will be the key to leading the global economy forward. The U.S. government has stressed the importance of the region, and recent statements and actions by President Obama and Secretary Hillary Clinton have reflected the move in this direction. This is also a time when Taiwan is seeking to reposition itself in light of global economic and potential and political restructuring. At this critical juncture, I wish to call on establishing a new strategic partnership between Taiwan and the U.S. for the following reasons. One, both Taiwan and the U.S. share common interests in and responsibility for regional security and stability, particularly with the rise of China. Taiwan and the U.S. need to have ever closer and stronger cooperation in order to jointly maintain peace, stability, and prosperity in the region. Second, for decades, Taiwan and the U.S. have both been firm believers in and committed to the principles of free trade. Taiwan has always kept pace with the U.S. in forming its trading rules and regulations. This common basis allows greater room for cooperation when working towards establishing a trading order for the region. Third, Taiwan and U.S. tradition of business partnership will be mutually beneficial in exploring new and emerging markets, particularly for markets in this region. This has been demonstrated in the Alliance for the IT Industry, with future opportunities, including development of new and emerging industries, green industries, biotechnology, alternative energy, and so forth. There's much room for cooperation and mutual benefit. The traditional close business relationship and cooperation will help us explore new and emerging markets, particularly China, Southeast Asia, India, and even Central and South America. By taking advantage of the business alliance between Taiwan and the U.S., we can be key contributors in the global economic recovery. The future of the new strategic partnership will need efforts from both sides, particularly efforts in the following areas. First of all, a peaceful and stable cross-strait relationship is key to continuing Taiwan and U.S. relations. When I am elected, of course, as the president of this country next year, I will place great efforts in maintaining peace and stability in Taiwan Strait. This is my responsibility towards the 23 million people in Taiwan and our responsibility as a regional partner of the other international players in the region. All indicators show that the presidential election will be a very close race. And there is a real possibility that I will win. Yes, this is what I'm waiting for. I understand that there are some people who may be worried about our victory. I will do whatever we can without compromising Taiwan's fundamental interests to ease tensions and foster an atmosphere where dialogue and interaction after the election is possible. Now, we are aware that cross-strait relations are a very important public policy matter, but in this election, there are other issues that are equally, if not more, important. These are issues relating to wealth gap, jobs, and the economy. Out of Taiwan's long-term interests, my approach on cross-strait policy during and after the election is to build consensus. Instead of driving a partisan wedge between different groups in Taiwan, we will not use cross-strait relations as a campaign tool. Our partisan differences in this election will be highlighted more in domestic policies. Although there are constraints on our interaction with the Chinese interlocutors during the election, we'll be proactive in seeking dialogue and stabilizing the relationship immediately following the election and throughout the transition period. Now, in the area of Taiwan and U.S. trade relations, I will pursue free trade policies and objectives, which I believe are the common goals shared by our two sides. I wish to point out that the Ma administration over the past 3 years have only actively pursued trade relations with China. The relationship was taken a step further with the signing of AFA in June 2010. By contrast, over the last 3 years, Taiwan-U.S. trade relations remained at a standstill. Many of you would know that Taiwan's keenest competitor in the global trade is the Republic of Korea. It brings me much worry to see the signing and coming into effect of FTA, the FTA between the EU and the Republic of Korea, as well as the FTA between the US and Korea. At the same time, there's little progress in the signing of FTAs between Taiwan and the US or any other major trading partners. I fully agree with MTN's continuing call on Taiwan's concerning the importance of a developing balanced trade relations. In this regard, there has not been much progress in the trade discussions between Taiwan and the US. The DPP's position has been that the US should take the lead in creating an APEC-based free trade agreement for the region, which would, of course, include Taiwan. I am therefore pleased to note that the US is spearheading the Trans-Pacific Partnership, that is TPP, among its APEC economies. When I visited the United States last September, the issue of the TPP was also raised in some meetings. The TPP has high standards for entry, and we must have the determination to prepare ourselves to join. Despite the Ma government's recent announcement of the intention to join the TPP, well, I don't really mind that if it's a TPP. All right, let me do it again. Despite the Ma government's recent announcement of the intention to join the TPP, we have yet to see the necessary determination and preparation made to facilitate such an effort. Now, in the 10-year policy platform of the DPP, we recognized the immediate need to carry out structural adjustments to the economy. We have a much more government involvement approach in helping the R&D phase of the startups in introducing focused programs to develop and modernize the agriculture sector and in building infrastructures for developing close links between the industries and local economies and for accelerating the emergence of new industries, which include, among others, R&D as an industry of its own, green energy, long-term care services, and medical care services. The intention is to improve our international competitiveness and to create quality job opportunities. These policies will not only breathe new life into the Taiwan economy, but will better prepare Taiwan for further liberalization of its markets in light of globalization. It is my belief that when DPP returns to the government, we will, in the shortest time possible, prepare Taiwan for joining the TPP. At the same time, we remain hopeful that the US and members of the MCHAN will provide us with the full support necessary in working towards the common goal of a Taiwan-US FTA and membership in the TPP. In addition, I should strengthen and promote Taiwan and the US exchanges. We should be enhancing the function and operation of TIFA, and on this basis, establish mechanisms to facilitate regular visits between high-level officials. Not only would this be conducive to resolving outstanding issues, but also it would contribute to furthering communication and understanding between the two sides for the way forward. It is therefore important to take action as soon as possible to resolve some of the outstanding disputes in our trade relationship so that there will be opportunities to build on TIFA and to move forward from there. Once elected, I will proactively manage the political complications arising from certain existing bilateral trade issues, so as to minimize the impact on our trade relationship with the U.S. They must be settled with the best long-term interests of Taiwanese people in mind, which involves more open and closer trade relations with the U.S. We will take steps to facilitate the mobility of international professionals and senior managerial personnel in and out of Taiwan, which we understand is an area that has concerned MCHAM. Taiwan has a need for quality talent, but we must first remove current administrative and legal constraints. Under the Ma government, the number of foreign laborers increased by 16% compared to that of 2007. However, by contrast, the number of international professionals decreased by 8% during the same period. This trend is taking us in the opposite direction of upgrading the quality of our human capital. Therefore, I propose introducing special regulations or even legislations to remove obstacles preventing the entry of senior experts and professionals. Now, when the DPP was in the government last time, I say this as a matter of conclusion, of course, Taiwan and the U.S. enjoyed direct communication with each other, working together in resolving trade issues and developing mutual understandings. I wish to take this opportunity to assure you that when the DPP is in the government again, the team will place quality communication as its highest priority. At the same time, I'm confident that communications between the DPP government and the US government and MCHAM were much improved, so that MCHAM's current complaints on government efficiency will be reduced drastically. I mean drastically. I am confident that I'm going to win the presidential election next year. I am looking forward to a prosperous future for Taiwan and U.S. relations, particularly in establishing a new strategic partnership. And I'm hopeful that we will be moving towards furthering and deepening our relationship, creating greater mutual benefits between Taiwan and the U.S., and creating greater benefits for Asia, for the Asia-Pacific region. Thank you, and I wish you all good health and prosperity. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Tsai. You touched upon a lot of points that our members are very concerning. We would like you to remain on the stage and help us draw three lucky winners for this book. Also, it's written by Dr. Tsai. The title is From Scrambled Eggs with Onions to Xiaoying Lunchbox. So if you want to find out what other thing is serving from the lunchbox, you need to read the book. And here, so.
Somebody thought that this is a recipe book.
Oh, this person bear this last name, Vincent Ma.
Vincent Ma. Please come to the stage as soon as possible.
Hopefully this is a tie.
Scott Miku?
Yeah.
Micron Technology.
Scott Miku.
Scott is also one of our candidates for governors.
And then Fragoso?
Cesar Fragoso. Mexican Trade Office. The book is also autographed by Dr. Tsai. Now, the portion that we have media's involved
will be concluded. 媒体朋友，谢谢你们今天的光临。那这个我们是目前相关的采访活动已经到此结束。谢谢大家，辛苦了。Okay. We will open to the floor for question and answer in 1 minute.
But let's talk about the book first.
What is the Amchen view on the candidates?
Excellent. Well,
What is the Amchen view on the candidates?
Excellent. Well, first off, I think the event came off extremely well. For our annual general meeting, it's the best one I've been to in quite a while. I really wanted to thank both presidential candidates for coming and spending time with us and giving us such in-depth speeches and Q&A. If I can just comment on the speeches, I wanted to go through, and I need access to my notes here for this, I wanted to comment on 5 themes that we heard from both candidates that I think we as a chamber were very impressed by. First is we heard resounding cross-strait stability is something everyone is both candidates are very interested in maintaining, and we as a business community are obviously interested in maintaining that, so I think there we're quite aligned. Secondly is on the topic of trade liberalization. So first we heard both candidates talking about liberalization of trade as being something they're putting in their platform, and both candidates even went so far as to say that TPP membership is something they're both pushing for. So again, as a business organization, we're extremely happy to see that that's a part of both parties' platforms. Third point I wanted to make is they both brought up the topic of talent. This is something we as a chamber are very concerned about, that Taiwan is running out of talent. We're losing talent to mainland China. We're also not developing enough talent here. And finally, we're not importing enough talent from the international community. Both candidates, again, talked about talent as a key part of their platform. We're extremely excited that they are going to be addressing that issue, regardless who wins the campaign. And then finally, we heard both candidates talking about domestic policy. And really, and I'm going to use President Ma's words here, both candidates really pointed this out. Going from an efficiency to an innovation-driven economy. Chairwoman Tsai talked about an R&D-driven economy. This is really talking about the same thing, but it's shifting the mix of industry away from manufacturing and efficiency-driven industries and more into innovation-driven industries. And we couldn't agree more. It's obviously going to take talent. It's going to take liberalization of trade to get there, but that's what needs to happen for the next 10 years. So we're very happy that we're completely aligned with both candidates' platforms as a chamber.
Was not invited to the event today. Is it because of scheduling, or is he?
Exactly, it was purely a scheduling difficulty. We had to arrange this event 2 months before. Candidate Tsung's obviously he just got permission to become a candidate in the election. This was purely and simply a scheduling difficulty.
In your opinion, whose speech is better than the other?
We were pleased with both speeches. I don't want to say that one or the other was better because they were both, frankly, right on the mark for what we needed to hear as a chamber.
Thank you.
我们再一次掌声欢迎蔡主席。
所以我也非常感谢今天有这个机会来到这里来跟我们的各位先进来请益来交换意见，而且我们也希望能够来有一个共同思考的过程。在一个变化很快但是充满不确定的未来里面，台湾的经济跟产业的下一步究竟要往哪里走，其实这是每一个人今天都在台湾问的问题。而我们的张平昭理事长刚刚也把这些问题都点出来了。那么我们现在面临的确实是一个全新的世界的局势。90年代我们讲这个WTO 的开放，2000年到2010年我们看到的世界开始有一连串的变化，在今天2011年甚至到明年的2012年，其实这个世界还是充满了震荡，也充满了变化。那我们也看到了一个正在震荡中的这个国际情势，而在震荡之中，这个国际要走向的是一个往上走的情势还是一个往下走的情势，而我们台湾这个国家这个经济体在这震荡之中，我们要怎么样能够维持我们自己国家跟经济的活力，恐怕是我们共同必须来思考也必须要挑起下一个世代的责任。那么全球的经贸环境在这几年短短的几年，就像我刚才讲的，其实是产生了很多剧烈的变化，很多过去台湾赖以发展的基础和过去很不一样，很多观念的制度也有了这种结构性的不同。那么例如我们在2008年的金融海啸之后，使得全球的金融体系必须进行结构性的调整。那么在台湾我们也面临这样的问题，尽管我们在台湾在民进党执政的时期，我们打消呆账接管这个不健全的金融机构，我们也希望能够我们的金融机构能够健全资本，能够使得金融秩序可以重建。那也就是因为在我们执政的时候整顿了这个金融机构，使得在2008年的时候台湾可以挺过这个金融的风暴。但是不可否认的，我们的金融市场跟金融产业是需要再一次的检视，必须做再一次的结构性的调整。那么尤其是我们的产业里面很多的不同的金融的事业，我们是不是有足够的全球竞争能力，这是我们必须要来考虑的。金融界我们的金融产业我们的金融机构将来我们要在国际间以什么来竞争。那么我们这几年来从90年代到今天，我们的金融界其实在消费金融在小型的房屋贷款也就是我们一般讲的 retail market 就是零售业的市场其实是做得不错，但是我们真的要走入到下一个阶段更有竞争力的金融产业，其实我们需要的几个东西，第一个就是我们金融产业能够研发创新新的金融商品的能力，那么第二我们必须要有投资银行能够替我们开拓更多我们可以投资的这种新型事业，或者是让我们的这个资金有好的投资的管道。那么同时我们也要有一定程度能够主导甚至自己参与大型的国际的融资的这种交易。那么这一些都是我们金融界所面临的将来要在国际间所必须要面临的这个竞争的能量。那我们也希望持续的希望我们的金融产业可以能够做调整，能够强化在国际竞争的能力。那么这个需要很多政府的支持，我必须要说。那么在人才的引进上面，在很多结构性的调整上面所需要的政府的监理机构也好，政府的行政资源也好，我们都会提供必要的协助。那么最重要的有一点我也必须要提出来， 也就是我们的金融监理机构。那我们的金融监理机构也必须要把它的监理能量把它强化，尤其是我们金融监理机构必须要熟悉市场，了解市场，而且能够更深入的去掌握每一项金融产品所衍生的风险，所以它才能够精确的去做规范，不至于为了让保护我们的投资大众而去限缩了我们业者的新型商品进入市场的空间。但是我也必须要讲，投资大众在面临越来越复杂的金融商品的时候，他所需要的投资的保护由金融监理机构的保护其实是更多的。那么除了这个之外，我们也看到欧美债务的危机也告诉我们，现在政府放任财政赤字将引发社会跟经济的负面的效果，那么包括国内投资的减少、信用平等的下降、通货膨胀、经济停滞以及社会的贫穷化。如果政府以滥用赤字来解决短期经济的手段的话，我们认为必须要有所节制。那么再来，我们新兴国家参与全球竞争，让我们必须更积极的投入知识的创新和应用，来维持我们的国际竞争力，解决我们产业外移、工作机会流失的问题。那么全球化所带来的高失业跟贫穷跟贫富差距的问题，使得我们必须要面对，而且共同面对一个挑战，就是我们必须要创造更多的工作机会。那么这变成我们经济发展上最重要的一个挑战，就是如何创造有高价值的这个工作机会给我们的人民。那么这也是今天政府所面临到最重要的责任。那么其外，除了这个之外，我们还是要面临到国际经济局势的重组。那么中国的崛起和它近年经济转型与成长的缓慢下来，以及韩国及欧美之间的 FTA 陆续生效，这些都是密切牵动台湾的全球经贸布局的策略。而台湾和主要国家的 FTA 近年来进展并不多，严重的影响台湾的国际的布局，这将是我们一大隐忧。刚才我们张理事长也提到同样的问题。那么还有全球暖化跟能源的问题，为了因应极端气候所带来的气候变迁，全世界的人都在思考如何在经济发展跟环境保护之间取得平衡。而日本的311福岛核灾更进一步提供我们对于能源政策的反思。福岛的核灾证明了核电是高风险高成本的发电方式，没有一个政府可以保证核电厂是绝对安全，这让我们惊觉台湾过去对绿能产业的投资是不足，而能源政策在缺乏长期的布局的情况下也走得很艰辛。那么在因应全国际局势的变化的同时，我们要检视台湾过去发展的策略，我们也不能忽视它所造成的内部的现象。那么包括产业结构、区域发展的失衡、环境生态、财政支出跟收入，也就是财政收支的问题，以及所得分配等各个面向的失衡问题，其实都是我们台湾今天的经济跟今天的这个国家所面临的种种的问题。那么这些新兴的挑战迫使政府和产业都必须要加快调整的步伐，才能追上大环境的变化的速度。所以在过去的两年，民进党虽然是在野党，但是我们也没有放弃执政的企图，没有放下让台湾有一个永续发展的机会的责任。所以在我亲自带领讨论的十年政纲里面，我们连结了执政人才跟很多学界的专家，还有很多实务界的专家，我们共同思考政策的方略，不断地在为2042年重返执政做好准备。我们所提出来的未来经济发展的策略，正是建立在对全新的国际情势的认知上，针对未来台湾的竞争力的提升，我们希望能够对症下药。那么我曾经不断地提到，台湾的产业发展
必须以两项策略来行塑，来面对国际跟国内的各项环境的冲击。第一个，我们必须要发展具有国际竞争力的知识经济和创新的产业，作为国际竞争的基础。那么我们也必须要协助企业在全球，包括在中国的布局，使企业独特的产品、知识技术、文化创意以及经营模式的利基能够扩大运用。那么第二个策略方向，就是要发展具有地方资源特色的在地经济，协助具有在地资源的特色的企业也能够得到投资的机会跟创造就业，并且能够满足国内市场的需要。那么甚至于在他们发展到完成到了一个成熟的情况的时候，我们还可以把这一些在地经济的产业推向国际市场。所以今天我要借这个机会来更详细的来说明我们的计划。这些计划听起来以前都听过，也不陌生，但是在我们的十年政纲里面，我们有非常非常具体的一个规划。那么第一个，发展知识经济，发展知识创新，在发展知识创新这个方面，那么台湾因为自由多元的文化以及长期参与国际竞争的经验，其实台湾的创新的潜能其实是非常高。但是台湾的企业多数是中小企业，不容易单独整合资源以完成创新，成为具有国际竞争力的创新事业。所以政府应该是积极的促成各种资源创新的活动的产业，使得投入研发创新的人在每一个阶段都能够得到必要的技术跟资金的支持，等到发展到适当的阶段的时候，就能够在市场上获利。那么要满足研发创新的支持，其实等到发展到适当的阶段的时候，就能够在市场上获利。那么要满足研发创新的支持，其实我们一直在提，但是我们一直没有聚焦在这个问题上的，就是育成中心跟创投基金。那么这两个应该在创新更早阶段、更早期的阶段就开始提供协助，如果在晚期再投入的话，我们很可能会错失了很多创新的机会。等到发展到适当的阶段的时候，就能够在市场上获利。那么要满足研发创新的支持，其实我们一直在提，但是我们一直没有聚焦在这个问题上的，就是育成中心跟创投基金。那么这两个应该在创新更早阶段、更早期的阶段就开始提供协助，如果在晚期再投入的话，我们很可能会错失了很多创新的机会。等到发展到适当的阶段的时候，就能够在市场上获利。那么要满足研发创新的支持，其实我们一直在提，但是我们一直没有聚焦在这个问题上的，就是育成中心跟创投基金。那么这两个应该在创新更早阶段、更早期的阶段就开始提供协助，如果在晚期再投入的话，我们很可能会错失了很多创新的机会。所以在各大学跟工研院也更应该提供更广泛的技术的服务。我们必须要提倡由资金的拥有者跟大企业提供天使基金和创投基金的风气，那么金融机构和中小企业的信用保证基金也应该以更多样的金融创新来协助我们创新创业者的取得资金的方式。那么现在的传统的贷款跟信用贷款，或许我们应该还要再想想看，是不是有其他的创新的方式来协助我们创新者在早期阶段所需要的资金的援助。那么很重要的一点是，我们会将发展一个产业，这个在产业在台湾将是一个新型的产业，这个产业我把它叫做研发产业。那我们很熟悉这个研发部门，在一个大型企业，不论是制造业跟或者是服务业的大型企业的一个研发部门，但是台湾一直缺少研发作为一个产业的一个基础工程。 那么我们也必须要建构起这个体制，让我们的研发产业研发自己做成作为一个产业的基础，那么建立我们研究成果，那么这个研发产业我们必须要有建立研究成果的转承机制跟市场的承接的平台，那么使得创新者的创意能够转换成为市场上的商品或者是技术，形成完整的创新产业链。今天我们这个产业链是没有建立，这个产业链是一个几个零散的这个成零散的组成，我们必须要把它组起来变成是一个完整的创新产业链。我们更会建构试验平台跟先驱科技的基地，使台湾成为新产品开发的最好的聚落。那么例如发展电子产业试验基地，建构以台湾为基地的实体运作的环境，以及建立生技产业的承接跟试验的平台，我们能够专注于产业的设计跟市场的需求。所以为了提升创新跟知识经济，我们应该要扩大欢迎外国高阶人才来台湾工作，以及外国创新企业来台上市与投资，特别是针对近年来国内高阶专业人才的短缺，我们必须优先检讨现行的法令，排除拘留、课税及行政程序等各方面的障碍，强化吸引全球专业人才来台工作的环境条件，并且借用他们的管理能力跟专业的技术，强化台湾产业的竞争力。那么就长期而言，台湾必须尽速推动必要的制度改革，以培养我们产业发展所需要的人才。高等教育必须更符合就业及产业的需要，各大学应该在各自明确的发展定位上有效运用资源，和企业一起扛起责任，培育符合市场需求的人才，提升人才的创新力和国际观。那么政府更应该协助我们的产业利用独到的知识跟创意的能力到国外投资生产，进而扩大全球市场，比如鼓励台湾的服务业将它独特的经营的模式，特别是生活方面的创新，转化成为可以输出或对外投资的商业服务模式，并以速度及管理能力的优势在市场上取得先机。那么台湾有部分的知识及文化创意产业在华人世界中具有相对的优势，因此我们也会针对智慧财产权的保护和贸易障碍的去除，积极地和中国进行相关的协商。那么在除了中国市场之外，台湾应该积极地开拓其他的市场。那么近年来新兴的国际市场如雨后春笋般的出现，政府应该和产业合作，寻求多元的发展。民进党政府过去已经和美国、日本、欧盟谋求以 TIFA 的方式逐步完成 FTA 的实质内容，那么这个我们叫做堆积木的模式，也就是我们在谈判上常常讲的叫做 building block， 这种贸易协商的方式将台湾的国际经贸空间打造完成。那么未来刚才我们也听到我们的理事长所提到的因应亚太自由贸易区的形成，我们更需要加速进行结构调整，做好因应开放竞争的准备工作。同时我们也应该积极展开和贸易对手国洽签 FTA， 并适时的推动加入泛太平洋战略经济伙伴的关系协定，那么也就是我们一般所称的 TPP。 那么我们也希望透过这一些区域性的或者多边性的这一些国际的组织跟国际的努力，能够循序渐进的融入全球化跟区域经济整合。那么其次我要讲的是我们发展在地经济，那么我们必须要正视在地经济，因为它提供了我们在不同的台湾的每一个角落工作的机会，让我们的区域发展的失衡的现象可以矫正。所以我们在推动在地经济的目的是为了强化我们内需市场的角色， 提供人民的生活品质，而且运用既有的人文自然的资源来促进在地的就业。那么我们更希望透过在地特色跟文化创意的发展，进一步帮助部分的产业取得独特的国际竞争力。全球化的本质，我相信在很多的层面就是越在地越国际。在地经济的特质不仅是让产品和服务在国内市场中能够与进口的商品竞争，它更是要借由特色来提高商品的竞争力，在国际市场上拓展空间。所以他们并非如我们的对手国民党所批评的，是要放弃全球市场而只重视内需。在地经济将启动内需与出口成长的双引擎，为台湾的经济注入活水，而且可以缓和三角贸易盛行下经济成长与国内就业脱钩的现象，那么造成结构性常态性的失业的问题。那么在地经济不只是农业，它包括了制造、服务、研发、能源、零件等各类型的产业，它应该是一个和知识创新并行的策略，也需要持续的研发创新，加入知识跟文化的成分，让产业更有竞争力。因此地方政府和在地的研究跟教育机构应该协助在地产业的科技研发跟文化的创意，培育相关的人才，那么中央政府也应该在资金上给予充分的协助。那么我相信各位先进一定非常非常的在意民进党的产业政策，我们的产业政策也依循着知识创新跟在地经济的两大策略。那么在制造业方面，我们努力的重点是要从过去的降低成本改为提升国际竞争力的知识创新，新兴的绿能产业、生物科技产业以及已经有深厚基础的电子资讯产业将是发展的重点。另外一个重点则是传统产业的升级转型，包括生产设备的改善，带动机电产业的高质化，同时将透过政府参与跟研究跟研发，打造产业的群聚，以及培育和引进必要的人才等等方式，和企业共同掌握这些产业当中台湾具有竞争潜力的项目来作为发展的重点。那么过去科技产业偏重于代工的制造，未来我们要让科技的产业走向与生活需求结合的运用，并且提升政府的公共管理跟社会的照护能力。所以在一些攸关未来的趋势及人民生活的关键领域，比如说公共安全、节能技术、人口老化、人文艺术、健康医疗、粮食安全、自然资源开发与保育、生物多样性的研究等领域，都是值得政府投入更多的研发资源跟基础建设，创造各行各业的高质便利的生活产业。没有错，这个叫做生活产业。那么在营建业方面，政府建设应该是以提升人民生活品质为目标，我们认为都市更新产业将是下一个投资的重点，借由政府所主导的老旧社区建筑的全面更新、节能建筑的推广以及都市机能的强化，未来数十年将能够提供营建业更大规模更稳定的商机，并且创造许多就业的机会，尤其是在都会地区。那么在服务业方面，我们将因应高龄化的社会的需要，快速的发展照顾服务体系，并且提升医疗产业的规模，我们也将改善传统的商圈的品质，使得小型的零售商能够借由商圈及自己的特色找到生存的空间，这是我们现在面临的最大的问题，也就是大型商场的出现压缩了我们小型零售商的空间。那么我们将协助餐饮观光跟其他个人服务产业发展适合台湾特色的生活方式跟服务的模式，以提升生活的品质并吸引国际的观光客，甚至成为到国外投资推展的基础。那么另外就是我刚才讲的，在金融方面，在技术研发以及人才培育等资源系统的相关产业都是我们的重点。农业跟地方的特产 以及其他在地经济的产业，也正是另外一个我们必须要推广的方向。我们将支持各大学和技职学院结合地方政府，协助在地产业的研发跟行销，先巩固扩大地方的特色，进而以此特色取得独特的国际竞争力。那么我们在中小企业的信保基金跟国发基金之外，我们也将另外筹1000亿的乡村发展基金来支持乡村产业的投资。最后，我知道很多先进也非常关切两岸关系，所以在经济策略跟产业策略之外，我们未来的两岸关系的发展也是我们企业界非常关心的事项。那么所有的指标都显示，总统大选的结果将会是一个非常接近的结果。那么这一次的选举是一个非常接近的选举，那么民进党很有可能会赢得这场选举。那我要跟各位说明，如果民进党在2012年赢得政权，我们会致力建立互惠互利的两岸关系，让两岸政策具有稳定性。我们也了解有一些人对民进党的胜选感到忧虑，我们认为在不减损台湾基本利益的前提下，我们会尽其可能的去缓和这种不安的气氛。一旦我们胜选，在长达4个月的政权交接期当中，我们就会积极的寻求与对岸对话的机会，透过诚意的沟通，让对方不会觉得大选之后的新局让他们感到不安。无论是选前或者是选后，基于台湾长远的利益，我的两岸政策主张都是强调台湾共识的建立，而不是去扩大内部的对立。因此，我不会将两岸关系当作选战的工具，或者是短期政治操弄的议题。两岸关系必须以国内共识为基础，才会走得长久、稳定。过去我在担任陆委会主委的期间，将1990年代国民党的三部政策转化成为依据 WTO 多边架构下的两岸经贸关系。我也成功地开启了小三通，推动包机直航，打下日后直航跟观光客来台的基础，并且为人员、贸易、投资、金融、科技等交流的层面建立制度跟风险的管制的管控的机制。那么未来我也会以台湾共识作为基础，继续维持与中国的稳定和谐的关系，务实交流。对于过去3年两岸签署的协议，人民有疑虑的部分，我们将会透过朝野协商的共识，以公开透明的原则来妥善处理。各位先进，在金融海啸之后，各国的经济都在历经再平衡的过程，也就是 rebalancing 以及结构调整的痛苦过程。我们看到的产业面对生存与竞争的困难与辛苦。未来民进党执政之后，我会做一个有担当的总统，打造一个充分沟通的团队，透过充分的对话来整合不同的立场，来解决所面对的问题。民进党绝对会支持产业的发展，因为产业发展的意义不仅是在于创造财富的累积，更在于提供人民充足的就业机会，并打造良好的生活环境。那么我充分的理解台湾的各项社会意识的高涨，为产业发展带来很大的挑战，但是我也相信，只要社会整体以社会整体利益极大化为目标，理性的沟通，诚恳的倾听，我们可以在各种立场之间找到均衡点，建立共同分享、共生共荣的价值。对于赢得明年初的总统选举，我充满信心，也深自期许，自己能够带领台湾突破环境的艰困挑战，利用台湾的优势与活力，创造全民共享的繁荣与经济的发展。最后，敬祝各位身体健康，万事如意，谢谢。
非常谢谢主席的说明，谢谢。在聆听了主席的说明之后，现在是综合座谈的时间。